morning. Good morning and welcome. I hope you're as excited as I am as we are about to worship in a minute or two. If you're watching online, it's so good to have you with us. This morning, in a moment, we're going to have a time of worship, and then after that, we're going to take communion together because it's the first Sunday of the month. So if you haven't already got one of the little communion cups, there is some at the front if you want to get them. And if you're watching online at home, if you want to prepare yourself as well for that, we'll be doing that in a little time. Then later on, Pastor Matt will be bringing us a second part of our series, Confident. And we're really excited to hear what the Lord wants to say to us through Matt. But just before we start and before we get into our time of worship, let's just take a moment to settle our hearts and to just commit the morning to the Lord. Let's pray together. Lord, we just thank you that you are here. Holy Spirit, we are so thankful that you want to be with us this morning and move through this place. And we just ask you to have freedom this morning to speak to our hearts, to challenge us. Lord, I pray, Lord, that as we come now to praise your name, we know that you inhabit the praises of your people, and we just ask you to move in a special way. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you speak to each of our hearts. Lord, just move now. We pray this in your wonderful, glorious name. Amen.
We believe, and the lost We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He's conquered death. We believe in His resurrection. And that He's coming back again.
You love me. You make all things work together. You today, and that no matter what you're facing, you can have peace inside. He works everything for good for those that love him. That's what the Bible says. So you might think that stuff's going on in your life, that what is going on, this just does not seem like this is God's plan for me, but he works all things, not some things. He works all things for good for those that love him. So fix your eyes on Jesus. Know he loves you. Know he loves you.
Thank you.
praise your name, Lord Jesus. Let's just continue to press in. Many of you here today have got things going on in your lives, and I want to encourage you to just press in right now. George, will maybe sing that just over again. And we are here in God's presence. Let's behold Him. Let's believe that the God that we're singing about, that the God that we're singing to, is here in this room, that He's with us and He wants to move in our lives. He wants to touch us. He wants to make us whole. Let's focus our hearts and our minds on Him today. Usually at this point, I'd stand here with a number of red cards that people need prayer for, but today there is no red cards. Now, I'm encouraged by that. That doesn't mean that there's not people in this room or at home that don't have issues. We still need to press and we still need to believe. We still need to pray. But I do have three green cards. Now, the first one of these is about Delia. Delia was last night. She was at the Love to Worship, and they prayed for her knee. She's been going through so much pain with that, and she's seen a massive improvement overnight with that. And we're just going to continue to pray that she has complete healing from that. Andrew also wanted me to point out, and it is a praise report, that young Josh behind us here is turning 16 tomorrow, but we're just so thankful and blessed to have him playing the drums week in, week out. And we praise God for Josh, and we praise God for our young people in this church as they step forward and they do things. And the final praise report is from Steve. Now, only Steve could bring this forward to us. There's only Steve would know this information. But he says, to the best of his knowledge, and we trust Steve, for the first time ever, we have 100 cars in the car park. So praise God, people are coming to hear about Jesus. Let's press in right now. Let's sing this again. And as we do, let's behold Him and believe that He is the God that can touch and heal and transform us. Let's sing together. Praise God.
Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold Him. Jesus, Alpha and Omega, our God, the risen Savior.
Jesus. You know, we're going to just come into a time of remembrance now. We're going to take communion together. For those of you that don't know what that is, we're going to remember what Jesus has done for us on Calvary's cross, that He paid the price for each of us. For those of us that are Christians, this is a really precious time for us. But it can be special to you as well, as we remember what Jesus did. Because Jesus died on the cross for every single one of us. It doesn't matter who you are or what you've done. He loves you so, so much. So much that He went and He died on the cross. And today we're going to take the emblems together in a moment. And I'm just going to read a few verses from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And they're verses that Paul wrote. And I'm reading it from the Message translation. Let me go over with you again exactly what goes on in the Lord's Supper and why it is so centrally important. I received my instructions from the Master Himself and passed them on to you. The Master Jesus, on the night of His betrayal, took bread. Having given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this to remember me. After supper, he did the same thing with the cup. This cup is my blood, my new covenant with you. Each time you drink this cup, remember me. What you must solemnly realize is that every time you eat this bread and every time you drink this cup, you reenact in your words and actions the death of the Master. You will be drawn back to this meal again and again until the Master returns. You must never let familiarity breed contempt. We're just going to do this now. We're going to take the wafer, and we're going to remember Jesus' body that was broken for each of us. So let's just do that together now. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name, Lord. And also we're going to drink the juice that reminds us of the blood that Jesus shed on Calvary's cross. The blood that saved us from our sins and the blood that sets us free. Lord, we just thank you. We just thank you so much. We just thank you so much that we can come around your table and we can remember. We can remember so clearly what you've done for each of us. We thank you for the sacrifice you made for us. Not one in this room or even anywhere in this world deserved it. But you showed us grace, abundant grace. And we thank you for that forgiveness. Lord, I just pray for those in this room today and watching online that don't know you in that personal way, Lord. And I pray that you just continue to speak to their hearts and their minds, Lord. Lord, we just love you so, so much. We just praise your name, Lord. Praise your name. Just before we go in, we're going to sing one more song in a moment, but just before that, just going to invite Alison to come in and just share something that God's put on her heart.
Good morning, everyone. It was just while we were singing about how God works everything for the good for those who love him in that song. And I feel that the Lord gave me a picture, and the picture was of a plant. And on the surface of the soil, there's the leaves, but we don't know what's going on underneath the soil. And this plant grew into a potato plant. And under the soil, when the time was right, the potatoes were ready to harvest. So what the Lord is saying is, his timing is perfect. It makes sense to wait on his timing. It also means that his promise is there for hope. It also means that there will be a harvest. There will be something to bless you at the end of this dark time. And for anybody who is having such a hard time, the Lord is with you through it. Just as he sends the rain to water the plant, just as the nutrients are in the soil to grow the potatoes, he will provide everything that you need. And just remember, his timing is so perfect.
Thank you so much for that. We're just going to sing a song now, a song that it's really precious to me. It's also a song I believe that can be used many times as an altar call, where if you are really searching. If you just read the lyrics as they come up and as we sing them, and you feel like God's speaking to you, you know, it's an opportunity. You don't have to wait till the end of the service or any time to make a decision to follow Jesus. Just let these words speak to your heart as we sing them through.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of the sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Oh, Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. To the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful?
We do just thank you, Lord. We thank you so much for our salvation. We thank you, Lord, so much for what you do in our lives each and every day, Lord. And Lord, I just bring those requests that have been brought to you today, Lord, and we just ask you, Lord, to move, Lord, in the lives of the people that are here in this building. Lord, I pray, Lord, for healing to flow where it needs to flow. Lord, I pray, Lord, for financial help and wherever that's needed as well. Lord, we just pray your blessings and your abundance to flow through this place, Lord. And we will worship you and we will glorify your name, Lord Jesus. We pray this all in your wonderful name. Amen. Amen. Just before you take your seats, if you want to turn around and say hello to each other. Okay, so we're going to start coming back into some sort of order. Thank you. If you are here for the first time today, I hope on the way in that you were given one of our welcome brochures, which will have also given you a little card. If you would love to fill that in for us and give it back to us, it would really be handy for us just to be able to connect with you. We want to try to make you feel as welcome as we possibly can. And also, you will have got, and I need to mention it, our very famous Lakeside pens. Wow. Thanks, mate. That's it. Just a few notices. Normally at this stage, we would have been saying about our tithe offering, but we're going to do that, our offering, at the end in the final song. So as we're going to pass the containers around, and we're so excited that we're doing this again, and it makes us feel we've moved a little bit further away from COVID again. Just a few notices for this week, some very important notices. First of all, Tuesday night at 7 p.m., we have our Alpha launch up in Banks. Now this, I believe wholeheartedly that this is so significant. This is such a significant thing that is happening on Tuesday night. We've got Rod Williams coming along, and he is fantastic. The last time he was here, he was absolutely brilliant. He does a little bit of magic. He's a bit of an illusionist, but he also has a fantastic testimony. And he brings it across so, so well. But here's the thing. We can put these things on. We can get excited about them. We can push them. But if we don't come along to support it and get behind it, then it can fall flat. And we don't want that to happen. There's been so much prayer that's gone into the work in Banks over the years. And I really believe this is pivotal in that area. We want to see Southport One for Jesus. We want to see Banks One for Jesus, don't we? So I don't care what you're doing on Tuesday night, cancel it. I mean that. I'm actually really, really serious about that. For one Tuesday night, let's pull all the stops out. Let's make real effort to get there. If you can't get, if you're sitting there and the reason you're saying you can't go is because you can't get there, speak to someone afterwards. Ask somebody who's got a car, are you going? And ask them, shame them into picking you up and taking you. Okay? we're all in this together. We're all in this together. Something really special is happening at it as well, and this should get an even bigger round of applause and excitement, is that we have somebody in this room who's going to be telling their story that is so transformational. Lindsay, stand to your feet, please. Now, anybody that's been at this church for any length of time will know that God has done remarkable, miraculous job with Lindsay and her life. And she's going to be sharing her story to her people, and that's significant. So guys, come on, let's get behind us. Let's get out on Tuesday night and support Lindsay and support the team. Richard and Debbie are going to be leading the team up over the next months. And it's so important we cover them in prayer. Richard, would you stand to your... Well, Richard and Debbie, stand to your feet a second. We're going to continue to pray for you, but they also need our help, especially on Tuesday night. We need some ushers. And we need some people to help serve the teas and coffees. So, guys, I don't expect to be able to speak to Richard and Debbie after church, because there's going to be so many of you around them, swarming them to say, I can serve some tea and coffee. I can make a tea. I can make a coffee. I can tell people where to sit. We can do this as a church, can't we?
Yes.
It's all, you may think it's a small thing, but it's a massive thing. And it helps us build relationships and leads people to Jesus. And that's all that is important. The other thing I want to mention is we have our safeguarding training on Saturday coming up from 9 o'clock to 1 o'clock. This is for anybody that works within kids, youth, or I think it's like prospects. We need you to come along and be part of this. You need to sign up. You can do that by going on line and doing it. But also, if you don't know how to do that, speak to someone in reception today or speak to Pastor Paul and he'll get that sorted for you. It's really important that we take this serious. It's for the safety of the church. It's for the safety of our children, our young people, and it's for our own safety that we know how to deal with situations properly. So please, if you're involved in any of those things, or if you're feeling that you would like to be part of that in the future, please sign up and come along to that as well. Very, very excited to invite Pastor Matt up onto the platform. He's going to come up now, and he's going to bring us our second part to our series called Confident. And I am excited to hear what God's going to say through Pastor Matt this morning. I'm sure you are too. We're just going to pray for him as he comes up onto the platform. Lord, we just thank you that you want to speak to us, Lord. Lord, I pray, Lord, right now, Lord, that every single heart will be open to what you're going to say. Lord, I pray an anointing, a special anointing upon Pastor Matt right now, Lord. I pray, Lord, that as he speaks, his words will be your words, and they will be like daggers into our hearts and encourage us and build us up and challenge us. Lord, we just pray this all in your wonderful, glorious name. Amen.
Amen. I want to just kind of dispel two rumors before I get started. First of all, I did intentionally get my hair cut like this. Second of all, it is not for a role in Peaky Blinders. So now we've got that out of the way. All the questions and the chatter can finish. Thanks for your appreciation. We're in the second week of our confidence series, trying to speak about confidence when you know people are thinking, is that the shape of your head? Really? But we're in the second week, and what I want to do today is talk to you about living without worry. This is something that we all face. This is an everyday battle of life, is worry and anxiety. And how do we live a confident life when life is uncertain? Really, what I can say to end the sermon here is that when life is uncertain, the one thing that we know, the one thing we hold to is that when life is uncertain, when we're unnerved by it, God isn't. God is faithful, he is consistent, he is always good and always kind, and he always works out his plan and his purpose. That's why we have confidence. Let's pray. That's the end. Done. But what I want to do is I want to build upon what Pastor Richard said last week as he looked at the Sermon on the Mount, where all these messages are from. He looked at the wise and the foolish builder and how the wise builder built his house on a firm, solid rock of a foundation. And when the storms of life came, they hit the house stood firm. But the foolish builder built his house on sand, and those same storms crumbled what he'd built. Now, we're to build our lives on Jesus, and we're to build our lives on his word. It's how we can have confidence in who our God is as we build our lives on him. And what I hope is that this message builds on top of that. So if you've got a Bible, turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. We're in this the most incredible sermon that you will ever read, that you will ever hear, is Jesus preaching the Sermon on the Mount. I always love the old thing people say, like, I've never heard God speak to me. If you want to hear God speak to you out loud, read the Bible out loud. Jesus speaks this incredible sermon to us in Matthew chapter 6, specifically, he's talking about worry. He faces so many different areas of life, but here specifically, he is direct. He is powerful. It is clear as day what he is saying. So let's read it. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. It says, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food? Thanks for that, Jesus. And the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? Why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Jesus is plain as day, direct and powerful. These words cut us to the core, and if I'm really open, most of you will know, see, Maria and I and the kids are moving in the summer to take on the leadership of the Elim Church in St. Albans. It's partly why the haircut is coming in. Just trying to get in with the southern people. It's what Clive said anyway. It's cool, apparently. In our move, there are so many unknown things. We don't know where we're going to live. We don't know where the kids are going to go to school. We don't know anybody. We don't know the area. I know one thing, that there are more Man United fans there, and that's a comforting thing to know. But there are so many things that I've been really worried about. Naturally, as a father, as a husband, and as a person, I am a real person. There have been worries, and preparing this message and looking at the words of Jesus, there have been a lot of tears in my office looking at God. This is what you say. This is what you tell us how to live. How can I worry when you are my God and you are telling me these things? So I'm preaching this message to you. Please know that I have preached this message multiple times to myself this week. This is something that is changing the way I think and changing the way I look. And I can't stand here with integrity and tell you how to live a life without worry if I'm worrying. And so I pray today God would give us a spirit of revelation in the knowledge of him so that we can live a life without worry. And you may be sat here today thinking, well, right now I am worrying about so many different things. Well, what Jesus says in verse 25, when he says, do not worry, do not be anxious, the Greek tense there is saying to stop worrying. I can't really give you much more than that. That's the limit of my Greek. Stop worrying. But you may be sat here today thinking, well, I'm not really worried about anything right now, and so this doesn't really apply to me. But you're dead wrong. Because then in verse 31, when Jesus says the same words, the Greek tense changes. He doesn't then say stop worrying. Now he's saying don't start worrying. So if you're worrying about something right now, stop. If you're not worrying about something right now, don't start. Could end it there. Jesus is really clear with what he's saying. And this Greek word, it comes from the root word anxious and worry, come from this Greek word called merizo. It means to divide. It means to be drawn in different directions. How many of you know when you worry, it feels like you are being pulled in so many different ways between, oh God, I want to trust you, but I don't think I can. I want to try to do it and fix it myself, but that's not really working. And now I've got this to think about, and I've got this to think about. I've got this situation, this problem going on. And we are pulled in so many different ways that we are at breaking point. It means to fret and to fear. Really worry, what worry is right at the center of it. Worry is an issue of the heart. And Solomon writes in Proverbs that we're to guard our hearts because all of the issues of life flow out of our hearts. The word that Jesus uses right at the start of this passage, he says, therefore, I tell you. He's linking it to what he's just said about so you can't serve God and money. Where your treasure is, there your heart is. If our heart is in this world, then if our treasure's in this world and we're seeking after things of this world, which will cause us to worry, that's where our heart is. Worry is just an issue of the heart, but the soul of this passage, the heart of this message, really is obedience to God. If we want to live a life without worry, we are called to be obedient to the one who created us and the one who sustains us, to be obedient to his word. It points us back to what Pastor Richard was saying last week. If we want to live a life without worry, we have to build our lives on Jesus and build our lives on his word. But when we look at the Bible, context and background is really important. It's really important that we understand where these things come from, because Jesus is not speaking to 21st century Christians in I don't know what fashion brands are. I know Matalan and Primark. That's the extent of my fashion. But Jesus is speaking to people who are sat on a mountainside, hence the name Sermon on the Mount. And he's speaking in Palestine where the temperatures are hot. Because of the temperatures and the seasons, that the mountains often aren't snow-capped, and so water doesn't trickle down for them to drink. So there was a big problem with dehydration, and through that death and horrendous poverty. Because they couldn't get the water, they couldn't feed their crops, they couldn't feed their livestock, so they had nothing to eat. But the crops and livestock were also their income, so they had nothing to sell to buy food and to buy water from others who've managed to get a crop. Because of the temperatures and the location, there were plagues of locusts that would eat their crops. So again, there's hardly ever food, there's hardly ever income. So he's speaking to people who this is an everyday, not just a concern, this is an everyday panic-filled worry of where is our food coming from? Where is our water coming from? Where is our clothing coming from? It makes the words that Jesus says when he says, do not be anxious. It makes them carry such more weight and authority when you realize they're spoken to people who really, really didn't have these things. And yet he's telling them, do not worry. And so I want to start at the end. I want to start at the verse that we know really well in verse 33. If you've been in and around church for any length of time through your life, you will know that verse 33 is a really central verse for us. He tells us to but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you. What he's showing us, Jesus, in this verse specifically is how we can live without worry. How is really important. This is the practical living out of what he's saying. And he's telling us how through the words. And I don't want to assume that we know these things. I don't want to assume that you know this verse. If you do, then I pray today God would breathe fresh life into it, because this is so, so key. If we want to live a life without worry. So the first word, he says, but. I told you this was going to be a simple breakdown. We're going to go word for a moment. He says the word but. The Greek word there is d. It means rather. What he's saying is rather than what's happened before, rather than worry, rather than be anxious, rather be like the Gentiles who seek after all these things. The Gentiles at this point are people who are outside of God's kingdom. The gospel hasn't been shared with anyone other than the Jews. And so Gentiles, they represent the pagans, the ungodly, the heathens. That's an old school word, isn't it? They represent the people outside of God's kingdom. And he's saying, rather than be like those outside God's kingdom, rather than worry and rather than be anxious, do this instead. So what is it he tells us to do? Well, first of all, he tells us to seek. Interestingly, the two words then that it talks about, the Gentiles seek after these things, is a different word than when he says seek after his kingdom. The Gentiles seek in such a way that they crave with an intense demand the things of this world. They crave the latest fashion. They craved social status. They craved to be known, and they craved to have luxurious abundance. And that picture of our world right now that craves with an intense demand the things that satisfy for a short time but don't have any eternal consequences. We crave the latest technology. We crave to be known. We crave to be wanted. We crave a great career. We crave a great friendships and relationships. Not necessarily bad things, but when they're not the first thing, they can be dangerous things. But the seek word that he uses about seeking his kingdom, it talks about seeking with a desire to worship and to submit to. It's completely polar opposite to how the world seeks. The world seeks to rise themselves up and be all that they can be and be powerful. But the Christian life is one where we are called to bow low and lift him up. It's where we bow our knee to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords and declare he is the one and only. And we must decrease so that he must increase. This is what he's talking about, of seeking God's kingdom, that we seek to worship the King. We seek to after him. We seek to submit to him, not just with the bits of our lives that we are happy submitting to him, but every part of our lives. He tells us to seek with a single-minded focus. If we want to make a difference in this world, which we do, if we as Lakeside want to make a difference in Southport and the surrounding areas, which we do, then we have to live with such a single-minded, focused devotion and commitment to God's kingdom and his ways so that we look different to the world. Because we're called to be in the world, yes, that's where our mission is, but we're not called to be of the world. We're called to look different, live different, sound different, think different to this world. Because God's kingdom is an upside-down kingdom. His goodness doesn't look like the world's goodness. His goodness is pure and perfect, and it is for us. And so we're told to seek this. We're told to seek it first. We're told to seek this not just so that other things can then happen afterwards and they're a bit more pliable. We're told to seek his kingdom first. It is the most important thing. It is the only thing that matters, is seeking after his kingdom, is seeking after the King, is submitting our lives to him. This is the chief of all things. People always wonder, what am I to do with my life? I don't know what I'm to do with my life. Whatever you do, whatever job you do, whether you are a doctor or a stay-at-home parent, whether you work in a supermarket or you're retired, it does not matter what you do. Your call and mission in life is to seek first his kingdom, is to make his things your priority, to make his word what you live by, to make his kingdom everything to you. Everything, because it is everything. He gave everything so that we could be part of it. Our only response is to give everything so that we can help other people be a part of his glorious, magnificent kingdom. We're told to seek it first. This is what matters. As Lakeside Church, this is what matters. We are here to seek God's kingdom and his righteousness. We want to seek after the King. We want to seek after him above all things. And he tells us then what we're to seek first. He tells us to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Kingdom is a word used throughout the gospel so many times. Matthew talks about the kingdom of heaven because he's writing to Jewish believers. The other gospels and into Paul's letters talks about the kingdom of God. Really, the kingdom, again, throwing loads of Greek out. I must have had some Greek food recently, surely. The Greek word is basileia. What he's talking about simply is God's reign. They talk about the reign and the rule of God above all things and how we as followers of Jesus have been brought under his reign so that he is our King and he is our Lord. So he rules and reigns over our lives. It's what Jesus taught us to pray. Your kingdom come. God, you come and reign over us. Come and reign over your church. Reign over this situation. When we pray for people who are sick, and if you're here today with something in your body that you want prayer for, we will pray God's kingdom would come over you so that he would reign over your body, so that what is out of line with his kingdom would come back in line with his divine law and order. How many of you just thought of the TV program when I said that? We're to seek his kingdom. Our submission is to his reign. It's to his rule. It's to his laws, his ways, his standards. That is what we are to seek after. That is what we are to live for. It's not, God, I want to live this way and I'll just sprinkle a little bit of Jesus on top of that. It is all or nothing. He wants hot believers, not cold believers. He wants hot believers, not lukewarm. He even promises for lukewarm, wishy-washy Christians that he will spit us out of his mouth. He wants believers. He wants his church on fire for him that will go into the world and burn so that people will see the brightness of his glory rising and shining on his church. We're told to seek first his kingdom, seek his reign above all things, but we're also told to seek his righteousness. Now, this is beautiful because there are two parts to what Jesus is saying. He's talking first and foremost about our position as righteous. Now, the gospel goes that we were dead in our sins and trespasses. We had no hope and no way out. Our sin kept us in darkness. It kept us lost and separated from God. And yet God sent his one and only Son to this earth so that whoever believes in him would not perish but would have everlasting eternal life. He who knew no sin, he became sin so that we could become what? The righteousness of God. This is the legal standing that we have now before the perfect holy God. We stand before him as righteous, clothed not with our own doing, not with things that we deserved or things that we earned. We stand before God clothed in the righteousness of the one who gave his life for us. It is the beauty of the gospel. We are clothed in things that we did not deserve, in things that we did not earn, in things that we had no way to pay, a debt that could not be resolved. And yet Jesus took the righteousness in his account and placed it in ours for eternity. That's our position. That is who we are right now. And scripture says that nothing can separate us from the love of God, not angels or demons or authorities or principalities or powers or heights and depths and widths. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing can change the position of righteousness that we hold because of Jesus, because he holds us in the palm of his hand. But Jesus here, he's talking about the practicalities of that righteousness. This is the application and the living out of that righteousness. What he's simply saying is that we are to seek after God's ways of living, to seek after God. What do you say in your word? What does this tell me to do? That is what I'm going to do. I will not alter for the left or from the right. I will stay solely focused on your word and what it tells me to do and how it tells me to live. Righteousness, he's talking about his holiness, because we are called to be otherly. We're called to be set apart and separate from the standards of this world, not called to mix standards. We can't be searching all things on the internet and then turning up on a Sunday and opening our mouths and worshiping God. We're called to a different way of living. We're called to live a life that is completely dedicated, solely given and submitted to God so that our ways follow his ways. That's a hard one, isn't it? Never said it was easy. We never promised that Christianity was easy. But it is good. That's our position. That's what we are to walk out, is to seek after God's ways of living, God's standards. Even however difficult it is, however much it requires of us, he gave everything so that we had this privilege. So the least that we can do is give everything to him. Grace is free. Discipleship costs your life. We're told to seek after his kingdom and his righteousness. What I love is that the psalmist writes in Psalm 84:11, he says, "No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly." No good thing will he withhold. Look at the promise that God has given. As we walk uprightly, as we seek his holiness and his standards, and as we seek to live and walk those out, he will withhold no good thing. Living life is actually really simple, because it just means one thing. Living without worry means living with faithfulness to God. If you want to live without worry, be faithful to his word. Be faithful to who he is. Be faithful to his character. Be faithful to his nature. Be faithful to who he has called you to be as his church, as his children, as the ones that he loves and the ones that he gave everything for. Be faithful to him, and we will live without worry. But all these things point to what he says at the end of this verse, that as we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, he says, all these things will be added to you. All these things, all the necessities of life. I can't stop singing Jungle Book in my head. It's so difficult. All of the bare necessities of life. I've said it. I've got it out there. I hopefully feel better now. all of these things in life will be added. The promise of God is there for us, and he is faithful. He has never lied, nor will he ever lie. He has never broken a promise, nor will he ever break a promise. And what he promises to those who follow him is that as we seek his kingdom first, as we make his kingdom and his righteousness a priority, he will give everything that we need. Philippians 4, Paul even writes to the church in Philippi to say that my God shall supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. He will supply. I love that he is my God, and he will supply every need according to his riches. Look what 2 Peter 1 verse 3 says, that his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. God has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. It's his power that has given them to us. So as we put him and his kingdom and righteousness as a priority, God will add all of these things to us. But what I think that points to is actually the end of that verse in 2 Peter. It says that his divine power is granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who has called us to his own glory and excellence. Because what that points us to is what I think actually is the fundamental thing that Jesus is talking about in these verses on the Sermon on the Mount. I think what he's telling us is why we can live a life without worry. Because the how is important. The practical living out of this is super important. But the why speaks to the heart of this. Because everything is found in why we can live a life without worry. Oswald Chambers, the Christian devotional writer, you may have read Utmost for His Highest. He writes this. He says, worry is an indication that we think God cannot look after us. Another writer goes on to say that worry is faith in the negative. Faith in the wrong kingdom. Worry is natural to a sinner, natural to somebody outside of God's kingdom, because it just demonstrates a lack of trust in God. And it's clear from what Jesus is saying that those who belong to God don't need to worry. There's no need for it, because he tells us, do not be anxious. David writes, the psalmist in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Is it one version says, I lack nothing. Why? Because he is our shepherd. Acts 17, 28 tells us that in him we live and we move and we have our being. It is in him that we live and it is in him that we move. It is in him we have our being. We have everything that we need in him. And all of this points us to the heart of why we can live a life without worry. It is because of what Jesus reveals to us of who our God is. As he says and reminds us again that he is our heavenly Father. He is our heavenly Father. It is who he is. And that is why we don't need to live a life that is filled with worry and anxiety, because of who our heavenly Father is. Look at the words in verse 26. It says, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Birds weren't made in the image of God. Birds weren't created to be joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Birds weren't the reason that God sent his son to earth to die on a cross. And yet he still provides for them. How much more value are we as those made in his image, designed to be joint heirs with Christ as the ones he came to save? How much more valuable are we to our heavenly Father? Look at what he says then in verse 28. And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field and how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? My God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Worry, I think worry really means that we're just being mastered by our circumstances and not by the truth of God's word. It misunderstands and it misrepresents our position as children of God. And it's important that we grasp this. This could change everything for us. I think worry is just an indication that we don't really know who our heavenly Father is. Preparing this message, thinking of all the things that I can worry about with our move, reminds me that, God, I don't know you like I want to know you, that I need to know you. It's no wonder that Paul prayed about the Ephesians, that God would give them the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that they may know what is the hope to which he's called us and what are the riches of his inheritance in the saints in Christ Jesus and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power that is towards us. We need to know who our God is. We need to know what he's called us to be. We need to know what he's called us to do. And all of that is based on who he is. Have we forgotten who our God is? Have we forgotten who our Heavenly Father is, that we worry and that we wonder where all these things are coming from, when he's promised that he will provide all of our needs as we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness? Our God is the all-present one. There is nowhere that he isn't. Wherever you go, whether you are down in the dumps or whether you are celebrating high on the mountains, God is with you. He promises never to leave you or forsake you. Our God is all-knowing. He knows the end from the beginning. Why? Because he created it. He designed it. He wrote your story. He knows how it turns out. The end of the book declares that we win. It declares our victory through Jesus Christ. Our God is all-knowing. He knows the situation that you're in. He knows the problem that you're facing, and he will supply every need that you have in that moment. It may not transform the situation in an instant, but it may give you the courage to walk through it. Our God is all powerful. There is none that can compare to him. There is no power in heaven or on earth. There is no authority above his. He is all powerful. It's not a contest between the devil and God. It's not even close. The devil is fighting a defeated war. He has already been defeated. And as we get closer to eternity, the full realization of the victory that Jesus Christ won will be realized. And we will step into glory as those saved by his grace through his victory. He is the all-powerful one. He answers prayers. Think of this, our Heavenly Father, the one who breathed and suns came out, the one who knows the names of stars, he knows our name, and he has all power. Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And that's who we serve. That's who we seek after. That's who we worship. That is who is our Heavenly Father. But Jesus says these words that cut us to the core. Oh, you of little faith. I'm really glad that he didn't say, oh, you of no faith. At least we've got somewhere to start from. Little faith in what? Little faith in God. Has God ever given us a reason to have little faith in him? Has God ever been faithless to us? Has God ever abandoned us? Has God ever not come through for us? It may not look like how we wanted it to look. It may not have been the answer that we expected. It may not be the situation that we would have chosen for the worst of our enemies. But God, what the enemy meant for evil, God will turn for good. His purpose is for good, like we sang, for those who love him and who are called according to his purpose, not ours. That's why we're called to submit to his kingdom. Why we can live a life without worry is because of our Father. And it points us to a beautiful story about Daniel. Daniel was an exile that was taken from his country, from Israel, and brought into Babylon, along with lots of other people, to serve under the king. And Babylon's a place that despised and rejected the living God, hated his God. And yet Daniel, it says that he has an excellent spirit. I love that about him, an excellent spirit. It's why at Lakeside, it's why we want to have our music sounding great and that we want to have the building looking great. It's why we want to serve you the best that we can and preach the best we can and serve you the best coffee we can, because we believe an excellent spirit honors and glorifies God. We believe it represents who he is, that he is excellent above all, and we want to display his glory to creation around us. But Daniel had this excellent spirit. So much so that he rose up the ranks to be above all the other officials, to the point where he was going to be placed over the kingdom under the king Darius at the time. And as you can imagine, the other officials didn't like that. And so they sought to kind of, in a nice way to say it, wipe Daniel out of the picture. And they created a document in connection with the law of God so that anyone who worshipped anyone other than King Darius would be killed. And took it to King Darius and he signed it. And what I love about Daniel is that it says in Daniel 6 that when he knew the document had been signed, he went home and he got on his knees and he gave thanks to God. How do you do that if you don't have a revelation of who God is? That when this document signed to kill you, when you do your daily routine of prayer, that's the first thing he goes to do. But obviously the king found out about it. And the story goes on that Daniel is thrown into the lion's den to be killed. And we're going to pick up the story in Daniel 6. Let me read some verses quickly. Daniel 6, verse 18. Then the king went to his palace, spent the night fasting. No diversions were brought to him, and sleep fled from him. Then at the break of day, the king arose and went in haste to the den of lions. As he came near to the den where Daniel was, he cried out in a tone of anguish. The king declared to Daniel, "O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Then Daniel said to the king, "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they have not harmed me, because I was found blameless before him and also before you, O king. I have done no harm." Then the king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. What we need is to know who our God is so that we can trust him. What we need is a hunger and a thirst to devour this book that he's given us so that we can know him. And as the Holy Spirit breathes life into that and our revelation, our picture of who God is grows, what happens is our trust in God grows. And as our trust in God grows, what happens is we realize really quickly that worry is just unnecessary for those who belong to him, who have the privilege of calling him our Father. I wonder if the band would come and join me. Our Father doesn't just provide the basics of life, but he provided the greatest need that we had, salvation. We were once far off, separated, had no chance to come back to God. There was no way home. Our sin was too great, and what we could offer was too small. The debt that was in our account was so large that we just weren't able to provide the sacrifice for it. We who were once far off have now been brought near through the blood of Jesus Christ. Those of us who were dead in our sins and trespasses, he has made us alive together in Christ. By grace, we have been saved. It is all his doing. He has provided everything that we need for life and godliness, not just in the here and now, but in the what is to come when we die. Because that time comes for all of us. Either God calls us home or he returns to take us home. One day that's going to happen and we will be faced with where we're going to spend eternity. And our Father in heaven has provided not just a way, but the only way to come to him. And he has declared Jesus about himself that he is the way, the truth, the life. So if you are searching here today, whether you're in the room watching online, if you're searching for life in here and now and life after death, Jesus is that life. And if you're searching for truth, what is the truth? What am I to do? Jesus is the truth. If you're searching for the way, Jesus is that way. If you are searching in darkness, trying to find some way out, Jesus is the one who made a way for you to come and call our God, our Father. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are." John even writes in his gospel in chapter 1, "But to all who did receive this, to all who received the good news, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." If you're here and you are a follower of Jesus, be reminded that you have the right to be called the child of the living God, that he is your Father and he will supply all of your needs according to his riches, that his purpose for you is good. It is to prosper you and to give you a hope and a future, that your soul and your security is sure in him, our steadfast, ever faithful, never changing God. But also know if you're here today and you feel far off and you do not know Jesus, that there is a way home. There is a way for you to come into his family, to receive everlasting life. And all we have to do is believe. This is how we live a life without worry, is because our confidence is in our God. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to pray. And if you're here today, if you're watching online, and if this is the first time that you have ever wanted to give your life to Jesus, and you're recognizing, I need to submit my life to you. I want to give my life to you. Come and forgive me of my sin. Wash me clean. Bring me home. Allow me, give me the right to call God my Father. Then pray this with me in the quiet of your heart. Let's close our eyes. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for me, to wash away my sin, to justify me and set me free so that I can spend eternity with you and that I can have life and life in all of its fullness. God, today I give my life to you. I make a declaration today that you are my Lord, you are my Savior, and my life belongs to you. Thank you that you are with me, and that now you have given me the right to become a child of God. Amen. I wonder, while everyone's eyes are closed and heads bowed, is there anyone here today who has made this decision, this commitment to give your life to Jesus? What I'm going to ask is that you just pop your hand up really quickly, just so we can see it. We believe discipleship is what we're called to as a church, and we want to come alongside you and help you live out this life. So is there anyone here today who wants to give their lives to Jesus for the very first time? Thank you. Bless you, sir. Let's leave it a couple more seconds. You know it's you. Your heart's pounding out your chest. You feel the conviction, what we call the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Is there anybody else here today choosing to give their life to the one who gave his for you? Great. Father, thank you for this man. Thank you that you have called him home today. And we pray that you would bless him mightily as he now changes position to be righteous before you, to be a child of God. I pray, Father, that you would help him see just how good and faithful you are. And I pray that over us as a church, Father, give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we would know you greater, so that we can live with confidence, to live a life without worry, knowing that you are our God, that you are our Father, and that you will supply every need that we have according to your riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Amen. Why don't we stand together and sing one final song? To
the answer to it all, Jesus, 'cause you wipe away all tears, you mend the broken heart, you're the answer to it all, Jesus. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you're the way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. You're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, the light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you're the waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, the light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are, 'cause that is who you are, that is who you are, oh, that is who you are, that is who you are, 'cause that is who you are, that is who you are, that is
who you are, Lord Jesus. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Pastor Matt, for bringing us that word this morning. I'd just like to say to you, I mentioned obviously earlier on about the Alpha and being in banks. It is in banks, but that doesn't mean that people from outside banks can't be invited to it. So I do want you to come on, we do want you to come on Tuesday night, but invite your friends, bring your unsaved friends with you. If you're here today and this has challenged you and you're not too sure about things, come on Tuesday night. Come on Tuesday night, seek more. It's so important that you don't walk away from that. Also, it's in the leisure center in Banks. Okay, so I don't know if I emphasized that, but it's in the leisure center in Banks, 7 p.m. Pray about it, church. Come to it, support it. Just want to thank you for coming today. In a moment, we're going to go upstairs and have teas and coffees. But let's just pray together as we go. Lord, I just pray a blessing upon each and every person that is here in this room today or watching online, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you just bless them abundantly, Lord. Lord, you see our hearts. You see our desire to see this town won for you, Lord. I pray, Lord, that as each person goes today, that you will put someone on their hearts to invite to Tuesday night. Lord, I pray, Lord, that they will respond and come, Lord, and that we will see something really special start to happen, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the way that you're moving in this town already and in this place, Lord. And we just praise your name and we glorify your name, Lord. And we just pray your blessings upon everyone now as they go, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Can we just show our appreciation to the band? They've been so amazing today. We've been so blessed by them all.
Pain is gone and mercy fills. bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity.